Greetings, everyone, and welcome to Virtual Worship at Christ the King on January 31st, 2021, the fourth Sunday after Epiphany. For readings, lyrics, and other important information, please see the video description below. Check in on our website, our Facebook page, and your email for frequent updates on our plans moving forward.
We begin our worship service with our invocation. We gather as we live in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Fiercest drought and storm, what heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. There in the ground, of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. Power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Let us together confess our sin. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your holy name, amen. And now receive these words of forgiveness for you. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ has died for you. And as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us pray together our prayer of the day. Compassionate God, you gather the whole universe into your radiant presence and continually reveal your Son as our Savior. Bring wholeness to all that is broken, and speak truth to us in our confusion, that all creation will see and know your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Today's first reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 through 20. Moses said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, 'If I hear the voice of the Lord my God any more, or ever again see this great fire, I will die.' Then the Lord replied to me, 'They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, or who presumes to speak in my name a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die.' The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." Our psalm for today is Psalm 111. Hallelujah! I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the assembly of the upright, in the congregation. Great are your works, O Lord, pondered by all who delight in them. Majesty and splendor mark your deeds, and your righteousness endures forever. You cause your wonders to be remembered. You are gracious and full of compassion. You give food to those who fear you, remembering forever your covenant. You have shown your people the power of your works, in giving them the lands of the nations. The works of your hands are faithfulness and justice. All of your precepts are sure. They stand fast forever and ever, because they are done in truth and equity. You sent redemption to your people and commanded your covenant forever. Holy and awesome is your name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who practice this have a good understanding. God's praises endures forever. The second reading for today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 13. Now concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in fact there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. It is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge, since some have become so accustomed to idols until now, they still think of the food they eat as food offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us close to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you who possess knowledge eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ died are destroyed. But when you thus sin against members of your family and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is a cause of their failing, I will never eat meat so that I may not cause one of them to fall. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is the Holy Gospel, according to St. Mark, first chapter. They went to Capernaum, that is, Jesus and his disciples. And when the Sabbath came, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Just then there was in the synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you have to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And suddenly the unclean spirit, convulsing in him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. they were all amazed. And they kept asking one another, what is this? Is this a new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. At once, Jesus' fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This morning, let us begin with prayer. Let us pray. Gracious Lord God, for the spiritual that is all around us that we cannot see or sense or hear, we give you thanks for protecting us, for saving us from evil. We ask, Lord, that you would come to us today, speak to us through your word, calm our hearts and minds, and remind us again of your passion for your people. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this morning I'm going to do something a little bit different. I'm not going to start with some sort of captivating story or some sort of earth-shattering statistic or even a famous quotation. I'm going to look at a particular story, the one that I just read for you, the gospel story, in the Gospel of Mark, and I'm going to work through the questions of why Mark chose this particular story to begin an introduction to all those who have never heard of Jesus before. So let me start by giving a little bit of history. Mark was the very first written story, gospel of Jesus. Okay? It was written, 35 years after Jesus died. And then after his gospel, another 30 years passed by, 30 or 40 years, and two more gospels were written. That was Luke and Matthew. And then another 50 years after that, the Gospel of John was written. And each one of these gospels begins a little bit differently, but Matthew and Luke, who were the closest to Mark's gospel, they begin by telling about John the Baptist. They begin with the calling of the disciples, and then they start to go different directions. And it's Mark who chooses this unusual story that we had today about the exorcism of a man in the synagogue to be the first story that he tells to people who may be hearing for the very first time the story of Jesus. He starts with this very original story of the exorcism of the unclean, evil, demonic spirit. And I wonder why. Well, Mark chooses this to introduce people to Jesus' life and purpose and mission. And it's an unusual story, especially to be the first story told to people who have never heard of who Jesus is. Now, I understand how storytellers tell stories. They want to begin with something that will capture people's attention, something that will keep them interested, something that will want them to continue on reading the story. Maybe that's why Mark starts with this surprising, unique story about Jesus exorcising the demon in the man in the synagogue. Now, he could have told the stories like the other Gospels did, where they tell the Christmas story about Jesus' birth, where Matthew talks about the angels coming and visiting both Joseph and Mary. Could have been even John's beginning, where John talks about how Jesus is connected to the cosmic God of the universe. But no, he chooses this particular story, this story of an exorcism, of demons, and of Jesus casting those demons out. Now, allow me to just sift through this story a little bit with you to figure out why Mark chose this unusual, supernatural, miraculous story as the one to begin introducing the world to Jesus. Mark writes that Jesus enters into the synagogue in the city of Capernaum, a fairly good-sized city. The synagogue, as you may know, was the holy place, much like for us, the church, the very holy place for the Jewish people, the people of Israel. And Mark says that as Jesus and his disciples enter this holy place, they also enter it on the Sabbath day. Now, the Sabbath day is the one day of the week where the Jewish people, the Hebrew people, reserve for the glory of God, the praise, the worship of God, and only God. So on that day, it is written in their law that they do nothing else. They don't work, they don't play, they don't wash their donkeys, they don't do all the... All they do is concentrate on God and the Word of God. So Mark writes in very specific detail, telling the story about how Jesus enters the synagogue. And when he gets there, he listens, and then soon he speaks. Now, the people that are gathered there are like a congregation gathered, and their holy person, their rabbi, it would be like a priest or a pastor, is up giving them the Word of God. When Jesus interrupts and he starts teaching the teachers. And you can imagine their response to this. And so as he starts to speak and as he starts to teach, the people that are there are amazed. In the Greek, it's like they're just like totally freaked out that this person has the wisdom that he does. And he is not one of their religious authorities. And then they use that word. Where does he get this authority that he speaks with? Well, Mark continues to write on, to write his story of Jesus. And he says that in the synagogue, there was an unclean man who had within him an unclean, evil, demonic spirit. And Jesus sees him. You wonder why nobody else could see this demon in this person. None of the religious authorities seemed to see this person, but Jesus did. And so Jesus walks up to the person and he says to him, and he walks up to the person, and all of a sudden the person or the demon that is within him shouts out. He shouts out and he says, I know who you are. You are the Holy One sent from God. Have you come here to destroy us? This demon speaks through the man. And Jesus immediately shouts back at him and calls the demon out of the man. And this demonic, evil spirit comes out of the man. But it's interesting that he hears this demon say, "Have you come to destroy us?" Because as you read further on in Mark, you will discover that this question is asked of Jesus again and again and again, but not by the demons. They're asked by the religious authorities, by the scribes and the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Those people who are supposed to be the holy ones ask that question. Now, it's interesting that Mark ties together this question of where do you get your authority to the demonic and to the Pharisees. because both of them have the same agenda, have the same intention, and that is to seek and destroy and eventually kill Jesus. I want you to imagine, if you would, that you are reading this story for the very first time. You are somebody that was not there when Jesus was on. You were like we are today. And you're reading this story for the very first time. You didn't grow up in the church. And you read this story about Jesus of Nazareth. And the first thing that you hear about him is that he exercises a unclean, evil, demonic spirit out of a man in a synagogue. Now, if that was the first story that you heard, what would you do? Would you continue reading? Would that have sparked something in you that said, yeah, this is kind of a good story, I'm going to continue reading this? Would you be skeptical? Would you ask, does Mark really want us to believe that this happened? Or is he just writing fiction? After all, those of us who have been born after the age of reason, we are people of science. We are people of logic. We are people who demythologize many parts of the Bible because we know the science that they didn't know back then. We are cognitive thinkers, and so for us to imagine that a man was literally possessed by a demon and Jesus called that demon, that's really hard for us. Mark's controversial demon possession story, being told as the first story of Jesus, is risking that people will not continue to read or believe that what Mark is telling us is true. But Mark takes that risk, fully knowing that it might hurt the chances of unbelievers to trust that his gospel is true. Is it possible that Jesus could have exercised a demon within a person? After I graduated from Concordia College, I went to seminary. It's a graduate school for 4 more years to teach us how to be pastors. And at my seminary at the time, I was the first class that had 51% women, more women than men. We had people come from all over the world to study to be pastors. One of those people, Shadrach Mnyawe, he was from Tanzania. He was from a tribe that lived out in the bush, and that community raised money and for him to come to the United States. It's a great story. And Shadrach, he taught me some Swahili, Asante Sana Yesu. He was one of the most honest, the most trustworthy, the most faithful of people you would ever know. I mean, the guy was just phenomenal. And our whole class knew that, and we respected him very much. Well, I took a class with him called The Historicity of the Demonic in Christian Thought, taught by Dr. Walter Sundberg. And it was an examination of the history of the demons throughout not only the Bible, but throughout history. And so we were talking about things like demonic possession. And Dr. Sundberg said, now, how many people have witnessed or seen a demonic possession, someone possessed? Nobody raised their hand except Shadrach. His hand went up right away. And he looked around kind of like in amazement, like, am I the only one that is? So Dr. Sundberg said, well, Shadrach, why don't you tell us your story? And he was a little tentative, and he said, oh, okay. So he told this story. And the story was about an older woman in his tribe, a grandmother, who over the course of a couple years had really transformed. She used to be this loving, kind person, but now she was gossiping and backbiting and doing terrible things to people. And his people believe, literally, that demons can possess people. And so they determined that maybe she's possessed by a demon. And so the elders called her together, called her to come together with the tribe, and they were going to ask her some questions. And as they started asking these questions, she started to convulse and to throw up just the same thing that we heard in the gospel today. And Shadrach said he's like 260 pounds, he and four other men held her down. And at a certain time, when they were calling the demon out of this woman, she threw all the men at the same time off of her body. And then they came back and held her down. Now that's quite the story. And how do you understand that? I mean, I'm telling it to you secondhand, but I was there hearing the story from one of the most trusted people I know. And I believe that indeed happened. But what do you make of that? Demon possession. Now, I don't necessarily expect you to believe Shadrach's story. I mean, now you're hearing it a third time. And I don't expect you to just say, oh yeah, okay, I believe that, but what if it were true? What if it were true that there was another realm, another kingdom around us spiritually? And in that spiritual realm, there were angels, but there were also demons. Now, I don't know for sure how that works. I have never exercised or seen someone exercise a demon out of a person. I do know that the Catholic Church has a group of priests that will come and do an exorcism if they feel that there's a demon in a person. But I am going to tell you, and I'm going to warn you, that even though you might not see these literal demons coming out of people, that evil does indeed exist. Evil not only existed in Jesus' day, it exists today. And evil does not only manifest itself in tribes in Africa, it also manifests itself in people here today in the good old U.S. of A. Now, I can tell you many stories of people that have committed horrendous evil acts. People who, well, we should say it this way, people who, if they were in their right mind, would never have thought of committing these acts. But for some reason, some force within them caused them to do these heinous and evil crimes. When the people who were in the synagogue saw Jesus call the evil demonic spirit out of the man, it says that they too were amazed. They were shocked. They were astonished beyond measure. And then they could not help themselves but to continue asking questions. Questions like, who is this Jesus? Does he possess some sort of new teaching, technology, no teaching? This is what they said. And where does he get it? Where does that authority come from that even the evil, demonic spirits obey him. Well, Mark concludes this story with these words from verse 28. At once, Jesus' fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee, period, after this happened. Well, duh. If something would happen like that here in Moorhead, wouldn't you think it would spread pretty quickly? Well, if you were there, what would you have believed? Do you think that Mark used the best story he could to introduce the world to Jesus? Do you think this was one of the best ways to tell people who have never heard of Jesus about his life and mission? Do you believe that unclean, evil, demonic spirits exist? Or that Jesus has the authority to command evil spirits out of people? Well, let me put it a different way. What would it take for you to believe in a story like Shadrach and Yahweh's? The possession, the literal possession of a man by an unclean, evil, demonic spirit. What would it take? Would it have to be that you saw it with your own eyes? Would you believe it if you heard it from a reliable witness, someone you trusted and knew would tell you the truth? Or would you believe it if you read it in a book that you considered to be true? What can we believe about this story of Mark's? Did Jesus really perform an exorcism? Does evil still exist today? And if so, is it only Jesus who has the authority to exorcise them? What do you think? Does evil still exist today, in our time? Let me tell you a story. Andy, and that is his real name, not the Andy who is our chef here at Christ the King, but a different Andy from a different place and time, had everything that you would want to have in this lifetime. He was living the American dream. He was married to a great woman. They had two children, a boy and a girl. He had a great six-figure job, and this is like 20 years ago. They had a house, cars that you and I would envy over. He had a lifestyle that paralleled the Kardashians. Well, maybe not so much that, but he had a great lifestyle. But something happened. It happened subtly and it happened unexpectedly, that something took over Andy's life. You could say it possessed him. Now, as this was going on with him, it didn't take long before Andy started to disassociate himself from his family. He started to miss all his kids' events. He started to stay out late at night and come home and lie to his family, to his wife and his children, where he had been and what he was doing. Eventually, this thing within him cost him his job, his career, his reputation, all these things that he had built up and was living came crashing down. Andy sacrificed all these things for a possession, something that he could not control. He sacrificed all these things in order to please this evil that was within him. And the day came when Andy found himself facing 8 to 10 years in the Stillwater Correctional Facility in Minnesota. All because of this unclean, evil, demonic spirit that had taken over his life, giving him an appetite for a drug that would end up costing him his whole family, something he could not resist. Who would ever give up everything they had, give up everything they valued, give up everything they possessed over a drug? It sounds like being possessed. Now, this is called evil. And evil cannot be fought against by ourselves. And evil's purpose is to seek to destroy and eventually kill. And we have no power over it. Now, Andy's story is not unique. In fact, I would venture that all of you have stories of family members, friends, people you know that have been possessed by something, that they started acting and doing things that in their right mind they would never ever do, but it just kind of took over their lives and cost them everything that meant and everything that was important to them in their lives. Well, as for Andy, to tell you the rest of the story, he was one of the lucky ones. He finally, in prison, gave up his fight against evil on his own. And while he was incarcerated, Andy opened the Bible. And the first story, the first gospel Andy read was the Gospel of Mark. And Andy likes to say, these days, if Christ hadn't found me, I wouldn't be here today. I'd be dead. And let me tell you, these days, as I said, Andy is one of the lucky ones. He started over. He got out of prison early. He started washing dishes. He started at the bottom, but he started to work his way up. He got married again to a very nice person. He went on to have 2 more children, both boys this time. Today he owns a couple of businesses and he is living the American dream. But this time, Andy has been freed from this unclean, evil, demonic spirit that once had possessed him. And he's been freed forever. Oh, and one more thing that remains is that Andy is not the only one that's ever been possessed. And he's not the only one that'll be possessed again. Is it true that demons exist and can possess us? Well, this last year, 2020, we, along with the rest of the world, have been fighting off an unclean, evil, demonic spirit that has come to us in the form of a virus. It's said now that 1 out of every 500 Americans has died from COVID. We are in the midst of fighting demons that exist all around us. And there is only one authority, one that we know of at least, that can exorcise these demons. And here's what Jesus did in this story of Mark. Jesus identified the evil. Jesus recognized it and called it for what it was. Jesus then called to the spirit and the demonic spirit and called it out of them, took it away from them so it would never be there again. And then Jesus sends that demonic, evil, unclean spirit back to hell or wherever it came from forever. Now you might say, oh, pastor, this is my mom's voice, that's really a scary story. You shouldn't be telling me, you know, scary stories like that. Well, it's not my story. It's Mark's story. And you may be saying, well, you know, it's interesting and it's inspiring, but really, really, exorcisms, demonic spirits, authority to cast out demons, really? Well, what are we supposed to believe? What are we supposed to do? We, after all, are not Jesus. And we obviously can't fight evil on our own. We don't have that kind of authority. Or maybe we do. If you continue on and read in the Gospel of Mark, you'll come to chapter 6, and verse 4 says this. Jesus called the 12 and sent them out two by two and gave them authority over unclean, evil, demonic spirits. Unquote. Oh, and by the way, you can also find those same words in Luke and Matthew and John. What do you believe? And who has the authority to cast out unclean, evil, and demonic spirits? Let us pray. Gracious Lord God, we give you all the authority over our lives. We realize that there are things that we cannot explain with our senses. And we know that there is evil all around us. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with us to cast out those demons, to send them to places far from us, to rid our own bodies and our families of these evils that we cannot fight by ourselves. Give us courage, Lord, to call upon your name whenever we see systems or individuals, evil amongst us, that is seeking to destroy and kill. Calm our hearts now, Lord, and give us the resolve to each and every day give to you all the glory, honor, and praise. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Of a sea, there's a something more than all, greater good because of evil, larger mercy through the fall. Make our love, O God, more faithful. Let us take you at your word, and our lives will be thanksgiving for the goodness of our Lord.
Let us firm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us now pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Let us pray. Gracious Lord God, we give you thanks for your Son, Jesus, who not only died for us, but who has conquered death and the evil one. We pray for all those who are possessed by an addiction or any sort of demon that comes to destroy and kill us. We give you thanks, Lord, that you're with us to conquer even evil. We pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear your prayer. Gracious God, we pray for the works in your creation, plants, animals, water, soil, the forest and farms, and for all those tasked with protecting our natural resources. Of all that exists in this your creation, we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord God, we pray for government and for leaders. In cities, nations, we pray for those who work in the legal profession, lawyers and attorneys, those who are elected officials, organizers, all those who are responsible for the well-being of our society. We pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we pray for all those who suffer, those who are suffering today in mind, body, Spirit. We pray for those who are sick, those who are in the hospital, those who are recovering at home. We pray especially for those who are in hospice as they face the last days of their life here. For those who are struggling with mental illness and emotional anxiety, for those who are hungry and homeless. We pray for caregivers, for health workers, for health aides, for all those who help in those times when we need them the most, we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord God, we pray for Christ the King. We pray for all of those members and friends and family who are traveling. We pray for those who are absent, for those who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries, for the people of God in this place, and for all other needs that we might have in our community, we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord God, for the promise that you made within the waters of baptism, we give you thanks. We who have died to sin have been raised to new life in you. We give you thanks, O Lord. We pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. It is into your hands, O Lord, that we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make God's face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace, deep and lasting peace, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.